Worthy to be adored, worthy to be magnified. There's no one like him. He reigns forevermore. He is the source of life. Give him glory, give him honor, give him adoration. Thank him that we are still alive today. Bless his holy name for all he has done for you thus far. Give him glory, give him honor, give him adoration. Tell him you love him. Tell him you appreciate him. Praise him for seeing you through the first half of this year. He's worthy to be praised. He's worthy. He's worthy. Oh yes, he's worthy to be praised. Worthy to be adored. Worthy to be magnified. No one like him. The Ancient of Days, the unchangeable Lord, the God of the beginning, the God of the end, the God of the in-between. Praise him. It's worthy to be praised. It's worthy to be praised. It's worthy to be adored. It's worthy. Oh, glory be to God. Ramosheke Randra Mokoronda Makashanta. You're worthy to be praised, Daddy. Blessed be your holy name. Blessed be your holy name. Blessed be your holy name forever and ever. Blessed be your holy name. Thank you, Father. Glory be to your holy name, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have worshipped. Now lift your voice to him and say, Father, during the second half of this year, let me harvest joy abundantly. Let's go ahead and talk to the Almighty God. During the second half of this year, let me harvest joy abundantly. Let me harvest life abundantly. Let me harvest miracles, signs, wonders, abundantly. Let the second half of this year be one of glorious harvests for me. Harvest of joy. Harvest of peace. Harvest of miracles, signs, wonders. Harvest of life, abundant life. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Forever, oh. Thy word is settled in heaven, it is settled in heaven forever, forever. Thank you, Father. King of kings and Lord of lords, the source of life, the source of joy, the source of strength, the source of power, the source of miracles, the source of blessings, we worship you. Please accept our worship in Jesus' name. You said in your word that is forever settled, that you have come that we may have life and have it more abundantly. Tonight in all our lives, Father, fulfill your word. Give us life more abundantly.
It looks like a case that the...
Give us health, give us joy, give us peace. Give us breakthroughs tonight. Answer all our prayers tonight, O Lord. And at the end of it all, let your name be glorified. And Father, we are praying for all your children who are listening all over the world. Today, grant their request. For every one of us, my Father and my God, let this be a night never to be forgotten. As for your partners, my Father and my God, like never before, this month, prosper them. Take them to greater heights. Move them from glory to glory. Move them from joy to joy. And Lord, I pray that by the time we finish tonight, every one of us will sing a new song. Thank you, my Father and my God. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Well, let someone shout hallelujah. Shake hands with one or two people and say, God will bless you mightily tonight. And then you may please be seated. Now, all those who are born in the month of July, will you please stand? If you are born in July, let me hear you shout hallelujah. July is a very special month in my home. And I'm sure you know the reason why. I think July children are special children. Glory be to God. Born in the month of perfection. My Father, my God, I commit all July children into your hands. Every one of them, my Father and my God, anything that has to do with them, perfect, O Lord. Give them perfect joy, perfect peace, perfect health, perfect success, perfect breakthroughs, perfect testimonies, and give them a new beginning of joy. A new beginning of success. A new beginning of anointing. And draw them closer to yourself. And let them serve you to the very end. And let their new year be far, far better than the previous ones. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, our convention is here at last. Tonight we are having the Disciples Convention. That means by this time next month, we'll be having our annual convention. And that will be from August the 3rd to August the 9th. The theme this year is the All-Sufficient God. The theme alone is enough to tell you that if you come to the convention, there's nothing you want from God that you won't get during the convention. But then, like I've always told you, the convention is not for just anyone. The convention is for those who mean serious business with God. So if you know you are just coming to chat, you want to come to while away time, please stay away. The convention is different from other meetings. The convention is specially for those who mean serious business with God. My children will say, well, why don't you say, come one, come all? No. Only those who want to do serious business with God are welcome. Because during the convention, we automatically have accommodation problem. So, if you are not coming for serious business, stay home so that those who are serious will be able to have a wonderful time in the presence of God. So, tell your friends they are welcome, provided they are coming for serious business with God. Who are the kind of people who are welcome? If you are not coming for serious business, stay home. Have a nice time. You will hear the testimonies. But those of us who are serious with God, those of us who are hungry for Him, who are thirsty for Him, those of us who want to go from glory to glory, those of us who want the power of the Almighty God to become a blessing to the world. This year's convention is going to be absolutely awesome. You can't talk about the all-sufficient God and go away empty. It's not possible. When you talk about God the healer, He heals. When you talk about God the provider, He provides. When you talk about God the deliverer, He delivers. When you talk about God the all-sufficient God, I'm excited already. This year's convention, absolute heaven on earth. So if you don't mean business, please don't come. I hope I made that one abundantly clear. Now, several years ago, I think it was around 1976 or something, I began to gather a little group of young boys and young girls together. As we were preparing for our first Christ Redeemers Congress, and we called them Bible study leaders. And you could call them a kind of Sunday school teachers, only they don't teach on Sundays alone. But when we go for the Congress, we break into small groups and we do in-depth study of the Word of God. Now, those who help me teach during such a program, we call them Bible study leaders. There were very few in those days. I think when we started, we were 33. The number grew, of course, steadily as the program became well known. But then in 1985, I had a discussion with a man of God who told me, and he's going to be with the Lord now, Pastor S.G. Elton of blessed memory. By then I have been general overseer for a couple of years. And he said to me, young man, I can see a great future for you and for your church. And for you to be able to handle what is coming, you are going to need some special disciples. I said, thank you, sir. I'll pray about it. He told me that in Elisha. And as I was driving down from Elisha to Lagos, praying over what he said, suddenly God gave me the idea that I must start a school. It won't be a Bible college, but it will be something entirely different. And it will be called School of Disciples, where I will be able to pour everything that is within me into these people, teach them three basic subjects. Subject number one, know your God. Because those who know their God shall be strong, and they shall do exploits. Subject number two, know your enemy. You cannot be an overcomer if you don't know who your enemy is. And I'm telling you, when we began to study know your enemy, we learned some new things. And subject number three, weapons of our warfare. You are not a Christian if you are not a disciple. Because from the day you are born again, you go into warfare. Anybody who tells you that as soon as you are born again, all your problems are over, is deceiving you. Because the day you become born again, the devil who has been holding you captive will discover that, hey, this fellow has escaped, and they will begin to pursue. And the elders will tell you, it is right for the slave to escape, and it is okay for the owner to pursue. And the word of God says it clearly, very clearly, that your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. That is life. That's the truth of it. And he succeeds in devouring some people. That's why you find that some people who started the Christian race never completed. Because they did not know their enemy, and they do not know how to fight. So we know our God, our commander-in-chief. We discover that once you're a Christian, you have been enrolled in the army of Christ. Because the word of God says clearly, endure hardness like soldiers of Christ. Our commander-in-chief, the Lord Jesus Christ, is not a civilian. He is the Lord of hosts. He is the greatest general, the greatest admiral, the greatest air marshal. All of them combined. And once you are born again, you enlist in his army. And he expects you to know how to fight. And he did not say run from the enemy. He said resist the devil. And he will flee from you. Resist. Not wrong. In all the armor, all the pieces of armor that God provided for you to put on, there is no peace for your back, because you are not to run from the enemy. The devil is to see you and run. So when I hear of a Christian who says he's running from witches and wizards, I know he's not a disciple. We are to cast out demons, not run away from them. Cast them out, not take them in. So 30 years ago, we started the school of disciples. And I give glory to God that today, the school of disciples is all over the world. All over the world. Last month, we graduated hundreds of them in Canada. We graduated hundreds of them in America. And everywhere we go, we graduate students from the school of disciples. So if you have not joined the school of disciples, you haven't even started the race. And if you join, even by the time you finish year one, you become a terror to the devil. And I taught the school consistently for 10 years, personally. Year one, year two, year, all the way to year 10. Of course, as I went on, I began to recruit some of my students to become teachers, since I can't be teaching 10 classes at the same time. And it was a glorious time. We will come here at night, we will study, go to the kitchen, prepare our own food, and eat mighty mounds of eba in the night. And when we finish that, we go right back to work, digging foundations, pouring concrete at night. And then we wake up in the morning and we cut grass, and you will be amazed the kind of people who are with us. Judges of appeal court, professors, traditional rulers, they joined the school of disciples because they wanted to know their God, they wanted to know their enemy, and they want to know how to fight. Today, by the grace of God, you can hardly find anyone on the altar here who has not passed through the school of disciples. So I'm appealing to those of you who have not joined the school of disciples, you better enroll now before it is too late. And the Lord will bless you as you do so. And so now, before I go on to the message for tonight, all the disciples who are here, all of you who have been through the school of disciples, or those of you who are still in the school of disciples, if you are here, stand on your feet. Wherever you are, all over the world, and you are listening to me, stand on your feet too. Disciples, let me hear you shout, hallelujah. When I ask you to shout hallelujah, I want you to shout disciples hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. I'm sure you know that one of our weapons of warfare is shouting hallelujah. Because by so doing, we frighten the devil. Disciples, shout hallelujah. My Father, my God, I want to thank you. I want to thank you for these, your disciples. I want to thank you for opening the school of disciples 30 years ago. I want to thank you for the growth that we had experienced. I want to thank you for all the prophecies that they heard from me 30 years ago, that have become fulfilled in their own lifetime. I want to thank you, Lord God Almighty, for the teachers who have taken over from me and are keeping the school going. Father, accept my thanks in Jesus' name. Father, these are your disciples. They know who you are. They know you are the Almighty. They know you are the Lord of hosts. They know you have never lost a war. Father, use them to do exploits for you in Jesus' name. They know that they don't have any other enemy other than the devil and their flesh. And so, my Father and my God, today again, I pray that whatever may still be alive in their flesh that can hinder the flow of your anointing, crucify it today. And I ask, Lord God Almighty, that like never before, when they command demons, they will obey instantly in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord God Almighty, that when these your disciples arrive, miracles will arrive, deliverance will arrive, healing will arrive, salvation will arrive, joy will arrive. And in their own homes too, my Father and my God, let there be always shouts of joy. And I pray that in your kingdom, I will see all of them there. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Disciples, greater works. Shout another hallelujah. Congratulations. God bless you. Happy anniversary. And thank you for the gifts that they say you sent, which I have not seen. If it is too small, I will send it back. Glory be to God. John chapter 10, verse 10. John chapter 10, verse 10. And I want to thank the Almighty God for my son who spoke before me. He did an excellent job, just like I expect from him. He has made the job easy for me. As a matter of fact, when he started going, I said, hey, this boy is going to finish my sermon before I preach it. It's a dangerous thing to ask an evangelist to speak before a pastor. It created problems for the pastor. But glory be to God. It doesn't matter how much the son knows. The father still has something else to add. But thank God for great sons, huh? Hallelujah. John chapter 10, verse 10. The thief cometh not, but for to steal, and to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. What is life? There are some things in the world that you think you know how to define, but you really don't know. If I say, what is distance? You will say, distance is the gap between two points. I say, okay, so what is gap? Oh, gap is a distance. If I say, what is time? You say, oh, time, that is what is measured in hours and minutes and seconds. And I'm not saying, how is time measured? I say, what is time? But if you are very deep, you know real philosophy, and when I say, what is time? You will say, time is a fragment of eternity. Beautiful. Then I say, what is eternity? Oh, eternity is time without end. So what is time? Time is a fragment of time without a... Suddenly you discover you can't define some of the things that you think you can define. The same goes for life. When I say, what is life? Life is living. So what is living? Well, living is being alive. So in higher mathematics or higher philosophy, when you come across something you cannot define, we go around it by defining it by what it is not. For example, we can say life is the opposite of death. Now that's easy. then that's correct. Because death is easy to define. What is death? Death is permanent separation from people, places, and things. That's death. Permanent separation from people, places, and things. Then you know the word permanent. Because when you travel, you are separated from the people you left behind. You are separated from your home. You are separated from your bed. Temporarily, because you come back. But when you are dead, the separation is permanent. So what is life? Life is the opposite of death. So that's going to help us tonight to understand what we're about to say. And I want to appeal to you that you pay serious attention tonight. This is the second time ever that I've made such an appeal, because all nights are special. But I remember several years ago, I gave a lecture on curses and blessings. That night, I appeal to everybody to pay special attention. Tonight, please pay special attention. What are you to do tonight? Since life is the opposite of death, to understand life, you need to know the direct associates of death. Those things that are associated with death. So that when you have life, those things that are associated with death will be absent from you. Number one is sorrow. Sorrow is a direct associate of death. In Mark chapter 5, verse 38, Mark 5, verse 38, by the time Jesus got to Jairus' house, whose daughter has just died, there was a lot of weeping and wailing. Weeping, wailing, sorrow is an associate of death. And that is why when Jesus comes into your life, what he wants to say to you first is, weep not. In Luke chapter 7, verse 11 to 15, Luke 7, verse 11 to 15, when he saw a widow going to bury her son, and everybody was weeping and wailing, he said, weep not. So when Jesus said, I've come that you may have life, you can take it from me straight away from that, that he's saying, if you allow me to come into your life, I will dry your tears. Because sorrow is linked to death, it follows that joy is linked to life. That's why he said in John 16, verse 24, John 16, verse 24, ask till your joy be full. Another direct associate of death is loss. When somebody dies, you lose him. Irreparably, it's gone. In Mark chapter 5 that I was referring to, verse 20 to 24, Mark 5, 20 to 24, Jairus had only one daughter. Her death means loss. Loss of heritage. Loss of somebody to continue with the line. In John 11, verse 39, John 11, 39, when Lazarus died, the sisters were heartbroken because it's their only brother, and now it looks as if he's gone forever. Loss is associated with death. Restoration is associated with life. Because restoration is the opposite of loss. So in Joel chapter 2, verse 25 to 27, Joel 2, 25 to 27, God promised that he will restore. So if there's anyone who has lost something that the enemy has stolen from him, in the name of the one who has come to bring life, there shall be restoration. Another thing that is a direct associate of death is loneliness. In Luke chapter 7 that I mentioned earlier on verse 11 to 15, Luke 7, 11 to 15, the reason the widow was so sad that she lost her only son was because there will be nobody now to stay with her in the house. Husband is dead, the only son now is dead. Thank God for restoration. Some years ago, one of my professors, when I was a lecturer, small lecturer at the University of Lagos, lost his wife. And he was a strong man. Nobody ever thought he could shed a tear. And then he began to weep like a baby. First day, second day, third day, so the children became alarmed. And they sent for me because they knew we were associated. And I rushed down there. I said, Daddy, I understand. I understand your weeping. The fellow you have been together with for 50 years, now suddenly you wake up in the morning, she's no longer there. I understand. He said, thank you. I know you will. In the name that's above every other name, everything that is causing you loneliness, God will take it away. That's why Jesus said in Hebrews 13 verse 5, Hebrews 13 verse 5, he said, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. When Jesus is by your side, loneliness is removed. It becomes as inseparable from you as your shadow. Psalm 121 verse 5. Psalm 121 verse 5. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. And then there, apart from the associates of death, because we need to understand, life is the opposite of death. Apart from the associates of death, sorrow, loss, loneliness, we have agents of death, messengers of death. And number one among those ones will be sickness, disease. Why do people get worried if somebody becomes sick? It is because sickness can lead to death. 2 Kings chapter 13, verse 14. 2 Kings chapter 13, verse 14. He said, Elisha was sick with the sickness whereby he died. Sickness can produce death. It's an agent of death. That's why Jesus, or it was said about Jesus in Exodus 15, verse 26. Exodus 15, verse 26, he said, I am the Lord that healeth thee. Sickness is the opposite of healing. Sickness is an agent of death. Healing is an agent of life. And he can heal anyone. Mark chapter 5, verse 25 to 34. Mark 5, 25 to 34 tells us about the woman with the issue of blood. She went from doctors to doctors to doctors until she came to Jesus Christ and she got her healing. And a good news for those of us who are here tonight in particular. My daddy told me in the prayer room, he's going to concentrate on healing here tonight. Oh, thank you, Father. Maybe he's waiting for me to announce it. He said there's someone here that the pain started between your shoulder blades, just from the back of your neck, between the shoulder blade. That's where the pain started. And then it began to spread downwards. See, now it has become almost unbearable. He said, maybe you didn't notice, but it is already gone. Thank you, Father. The Lord said there's someone here. He said the doctors called it pneumonia. But they have done all they could, and the pneumonia refused to go. Daddy asked me to tell you, it's already gone tonight. Sickness is an agent of death. Some of you have heard the testimony again and again of one of my children that had terminal cancer in Britain, and the doctors called the parents, sir, if you want your son to see his native land again, take him home now, because he has at most 2 weeks to live. Some of you have heard the testimony. I was way back in 1983. And then somebody said, oh, take him to the camp. They will pray for him. And they brought him. When I took a look at him, even my faith shook. Because I'm general, I said, I had to pretend. There's no problem. God will take care. Thank God he took care. I saw him in London 2 months ago. See, as healthy as ever. They told him 2 weeks in 1983. Today, more than 30 years later, he's still healthy, he's still strong. They told him because of chemotherapy, he can never have a child. so he shouldn't bother to marry. He went ahead and married, and now he has his own child. Glory be to God forevermore. And I stand here on behalf of my Father in heaven to say that every sickness, every disease, every agent of death in your body will disappear tonight. Believe it or not, another agent of death is poverty. You say, no, that can't be. Well, in 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 10 to 12, 1 Kings 17, verse 10 to 12, the widow of Zarephath said to Elijah, "We have only one meal left for me to eat with my son and die." Oh, some of us think we are poor. We are not poor at all. In the mighty name of Jesus, we will never know poverty. I repeat that again. In the mighty name of Jesus, we will never know poverty. Several years ago, I went to another nation. I won't mention the name because now they are listening to me all over the world. And when I got to the nation, my host said, "I want to show you something." Kilometers upon kilometers of burial ground, graveyards. And over, and he said that they buried those who died in the Second World War there. Those of you who know where they buried most of those people, by now you know where I'm talking about. And over each slab, there is a little tent made from cellophane. He said those who are so poor they have nowhere to stay are living in the cemetery. And they call the place the city of the dead. And these people, every day, they go out, father, mother, children, they go to refuse dump to go and search for grains of rice and bones that people have thrown away. I pray for you one more time. You will never know poverty. In 2 Kings chapter 6, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 26 to 29, 2 Kings 6, verse 26 to 29, it was recorded that when things got really bad in Samaria, two women living together reached an agreement. Both of them had a son. "Let's kill your son today and eat him. And tomorrow we will kill my son and eat him." So one day they killed the son of one woman, they ate the son. Now tell me, what killed that boy if it is not poverty? The second day, they now turn, the other woman turned to this woman and said, "Let's kill your son." He said, "Ah, no. He's gone to hide the son." So the woman who felt cheated ran to the king. That's how it was recorded. You said that can never happen in Nigeria. Really? A couple of years ago, they arrested a woman for selling her son. And she said, "You can do whatever you like with me, but hear my story first. We are dying of hunger. The reason I sold him is, at least whoever is buying him, we feed him. I have nothing to feed him with." What about the money you make? Well, it will keep me alive a little longer myself. Poverty. And I don't know if you read in the newspapers that there was a riot or something in one institution of Ireland. Why? Because a student went to hospital and they wouldn't treat him because there is no money to pay deposit in Nigeria. And so the boy died because there is no money to pay deposit. Poverty is an agent of death. And I decree in the name that's above every other name, poverty will leave you alone. That's why the one who has come that may have life, he said about him in Philippians 4 verse 19, Philippians 4 verse 19, but my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Another agent of death is hopelessness. When a man has hope, no matter how little, he clings to life. If there is a hope, and that's what keeps many people going. They hope that tomorrow may be all right too. You never can tell. Help may come. They cling to life. But when a man has lost all hope, he yields to death. In John chapter 5, verse 2 to 9, John 5, verse 2 to 9, the Bible tells us about a man who had been by the pool of Bethesda for 38 years, waiting for an opportunity to get into the pool first, after an angel who came once a year to stir the pool was stepping. 38 years, that's how long he had been sick. But he clung to life, hoping against hope that one day will be one day. Fortunately for him, the day came. Jesus walked to him and gave him healing. I don't know for how long you have been coming to Holy Ghost night, but tonight is the night Jesus will visit you. In 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 1 to 4, 1 Kings 19, verse 1 to 4, when Elijah, champion, great champion of God, when he thought he has brought revival to his nation, when he thought, at long last now, everybody is bowing down saying, Jehovah is Lord. And he came down to discover that Jezebel, the wife of the king, has not changed at all. In fact, she wanted to kill him. He concluded that there was no hope. What was it he said to God? Please kill me. Let me go. When a man loses hope, he could even commit suicide, could kill himself. Thank God for Jesus Christ. Colossians 1:27 says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. As long as you have Jesus Christ, there is hope. I was talking with one of my sons some days ago, and he said, the news, just the news, that his sister had cancer, the news was what killed her. Not the sickness. There was no sign yet of any trouble, but she had, that she had cancer. Weeks later, she was dead. Because somehow she just felt there's no hope. But there is a hope for the hopeless. His name is Jesus. You will never be hopeless in life. I've told you the story of my uncle before. Things got bad, really, really bad for him. So bad that he was taking the wrapper of his wife to make buba and soro. Things were bad. One day he decided, death is better than shame. So he made up his mind, he will commit suicide. But being a funny fellow, he decided he would go to church first. That he would sing, he would dance, like, you know, everybody would notice him. And then he would come home and commit suicide. And everybody would say, I bet we saw him in church. He said he would attend his own funeral. But as the preacher was preaching, he heard a word. And you will hear a word tonight. The preacher said, when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were being thrown into the fiery furnace, they did not know how God could deliver them. They did not know how. But God did. He said, I don't know how God can deliver me from my present situation, but I refuse to die. If he did it for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, he will do it for me. Hope rose. He refused to die. The day he was sharing his testimony, he had just bought 14 cars in a day. 14 cars in a day. Because hope came, prevented him from dying, and brought him to his prosperity. So if you are here tonight and you are already considering dying, don't die. Tomorrow will be all right. I say tomorrow will be all right. Turn to your neighbor and smile broadly. Say, my tomorrow will be all right. Thank you, Father. Daddy says that there are some people who have been battling with dizziness. You can't walk a long distance before you begin to feel dizzy. You can't walk, can't do any heavy job before you begin to feel dizzy. And some of you had even almost fainted. But Lord asked me to tell you, don't worry, that's over now. So when we talk about life, the kind of life Jesus was talking about, abundant life, it means much more than wealth. Some people think that when we say that fellow has abundant life, well, it's not because he has a big house or a big car, or that the children have bicycles and so on. No, 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 no. Abundant life means much more than wealth. Luke 12 verse 15 says, a man's life does not consist in the abundance of what he has. There are people who are rich financially, but if you get close to them, you say, I don't want this kind of life. I know one or two. They are not here tonight, so no problem. And I've told you the story before. I spent a night with a friend of mine, very rich man. It was time for breakfast. He asked me to wait for breakfast. I said, no problem. And it took him 30 minutes to decide what he will eat. The cook said, what will you want? Bacon, sausage, fish, chicken, this, that. And he struggled and struggled. Finally, he decided he will eat bread and egg. By then, it was about 25 minutes since he started permutating and combinating. And then the cook now went ahead and said, okay, how do you want the egg? Scrambled, poached, omelette, this, that. Finally, he said, boiled egg. Okay, how do you want the egg to be boiled? Hard boiled, medium boiled, rare boiled. He said medium. And the cook said medium boiled or medium rare. I said medium rare. How many minutes? And I was sitting down there hungry. Finally, the cook turned to me and said, sir, what will you? I said, everything you have, just put it on the table. I said, he said, yes. I said, yes, sir. How do you want the eggs? Well, just put eggs, plenty of it. I don't have money, but I have appetite. I can eat, man. Anything you don't want me to eat, don't put it on my table. Those of you who have appetite, who can eat, let me hear you shout hallelujah. Life, real, abundant life, includes joy. Nehemiah chapter 8 verse 10. Nehemiah chapter 8 verse 10 says, the joy of the Lord is your strength. And it's Jesus who gives joy. Psalm 16 verse 11. Psalm 16 verse 11. In his presence there is the fullness of joy. Good health is part and parcel of abundant life. Deuteronomy 34 verse 7. Deuteronomy 34 verse 7 tells us that Moses at 120 was strong, vibrant. His eyes were not dim. That man was still ready to marry a new wife if anyone was around. Good health. Companionship is part of what abundant life is made up of. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 to 12. Ecclesiastes 4, verse 9 to 12 says, two are better than one. No matter how much money you have, if you are lonely, you are lonely. Some people have all the money in the world, but they don't even have anybody to share their laughter with. Have you discovered that if you discover something funny, almost immediately you look for someone to share it with? Companionship is part of makes all abundant life. Glorious hope is part of abundant life. Romans chapter 5 verse 5. Romans 5 verse 5 says, hope maketh not ashamed. Ecclesiastes chapter 9 verse 4. Ecclesiastes 9 verse 4 says, a living dog is better than a dead lion. When there is hope, that's part of life. As they say, when there is life, there is hope. They go together. Ah, thank you, my Lord. It's a big one. The Lord said there's someone here, and the doctors have queried enlarged heart. He asked me to tell you, go for another test. You have a brand new heart. Thank you, Father. The Lord said there's someone here too. They said that there's very little they can do with your liver as it is. My daddy asked me to tell you, he has given you a brand new one. So when we talk about abundant life, so many things are involved. Good sleep, for example. Ability to lie down and sleep. That's part of life, abundant life. Told you about a man who came to us several years ago and said, I have 14 houses. 14. But in spite of all the sleeping pills that I take, I cannot sleep for more than 1 hour a day. He said, Pastor, I hear that if you pray for me, I will be healed. Heal me and take the 14 houses. I said, thank you, sir. I will pray for you. Jesus will heal you for free. I don't want your 14 houses because I want to be able to continue to sleep. I can sleep standing up. And I know there are one or two people like that here. Many a times when you kneel down to pray, if nobody wakes you up, it will be tomorrow morning. Am I telling the truth? If you have the ability to sleep, let me hear you shout hallelujah. So, you see, there are some things that money cannot buy. Some things that are precious, far, far more precious than money. But then, like my son who spoke before me said, whether or not you have life, it's a matter of choice. And I had him quoting Deuteronomy chapter 30 verse 19. Deuteronomy 30 verse 19. When the Almighty God said, I'm placing before you blessings and curses, life and death, but I advise you to choose life. So you have a choice. If you want to choose life, and listen carefully, in addition to the various things he had told you about, read Psalm 34 verse 12. Psalm 34 verse 12 says there are conditions you must fulfill. He said, any man who desires life, who loves many days, who wants to see good, Now take note of those statements. Because one could live long and live in sorrow. That's no life. One could live long and live in pain. That's no life. One could live long and barely survive. That's no life. No life at all. If you want to live long and you desire that those days will be good ones, he said there are certain things you must do. Number one, keep your tongue from evil. And your lips from speaking guile. The word of God is saying your mouth can decide whether you live abundant life or not. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. Proverbs 18, verse 21. It said, death and life are in the power of the tongue. The elders will tell you, they say it is the mouth of the one who is coughing that he uses to invite death. When he coughs once, twice, it looks as if this cough is going to kill him. I pray for every one of you here today, your mouth will not kill you. Next thing he asks you to do is depart from evil. Depart from evil. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 27. Proverbs 10, verse 27 says, the days of the wicked shall be shortened. And the Almighty God has appointed to every man days, certain number of days. But when he discovers that you are wicked, you refuse to repent, you refuse to do the will of God, he said those days can be shortened. He went on to say, not only must you depart from evil, you must do good. Proverbs 11 verse 8. Proverbs 11 verse 8 is called the law of substitution. And he says, the righteous is delivered out of trouble. The wicked cometh instead. In other words, if death is about to swallow a good man, God will say, no, 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 that's a good man, that you can't kill him. Leave him alone. I will give you somebody else to kill. You say, where do you find that in the Bible? Oh, I can give you several examples. Daniel chapter 6. Read the whole chapter. Daniel 6. Some people conspired against Daniel, an innocent servant of the Most High God. So they got him thrown into the den of lions. The lions saw him coming and they say, hey, here comes food. And God said, no, you're not going to eat this one. But God, you are the one who made us to eat flesh. God said, wait. Tomorrow you have plenty of food. After one night, they brought out Daniel alive. And the king said, those who conspire against Daniel, go down there and find out what happened to my lions. Before they reached the bottom of the pit, the lions finished them. The righteous is delivered out of trouble. The wicked cometh instead. That's one of the major reasons why you must not waste time to win every member of your family to Jesus Christ. Otherwise, when God is looking for a substitute, a substitution for a righteous man, I might grab one of them. Righteous is delivered out of trouble, but the wicked cometh inside. What is the next thing he said you should do if you want to live long? He said you must seek peace and pursue it. Seek peace and pursue it. That's because of the law of harvest. Galatians 6 verse 7. Galatians 6 verse 7. Thank you, Father. The Lord said there's someone here. When the sickness started, you were seeing traces of blood in your urine. Now you are urinating blood freely. He asked me to tell you, you can go and check in the toilet. The bleeding has stopped. Galatians 6, 7. The law of harvest. He said, whatever you sow, that's what you reap. You seek peace, peace will follow you. You pursue peace, peace will pursue you. And the other conditions for you to have life and have it more abundantly will be as follows. Love God. Deuteronomy 30 verse 20. Deuteronomy chapter 30 verse 20 said, God is your life. Love him, for he is your life. And Proverbs 8 verse 36. Proverbs 8 verse 36. The first time I read that passage, it shook me. God said in his word, he said, those who hate me love death. If you love God, you love life. You hate God, you love death. Love God. And the brother who took the offering said something. I don't know if you listen. He said, one of the ways you demonstrate how much you love God is by how much you give to him. Love is demonstrated by giving. God so loved the world, he gave. That woman sacrificed a precious ointment because she loved much. You want to live long? Love God. Another thing that will help you live long is fear God. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 27. Proverbs 10. Oh. The Lord said there's someone here tonight. He said you can't really call it headache. It's as if it is sharp pain, short, sharp pain in your head. Sharp, short, painful in the head. And the Lord said, it's gone now and it won't come back. Proverbs 10 verse 27 says, the fear of God prolongeth days. You know, just a minute or two ago, I said, the days can be shortened. The days of the wicked shall be shortened. The days of those who fear God can be lengthened. Love him. Fear him. Obey him. That's another one. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Proverbs 3. Verses 1 and 2, he says, if you will obey God, it will add to you length of days, long life, and peace. Obey Him. It will add to you length of days, long life, and peace. Next thing you must do, this is very important, if you want to live long, you want abundant life, is that you must beware of curses. Stay away from actions that attract curses. Human curses can kill. Numbers 22, verse 1 to 6. Numbers 22, verse 1 to 6. A king called Balak saw the children of Israel, that they were many. He said, how am I going to defeat these people? So he went to look for a man called Balaam and said, please come. Pronounce a curse on them, and then I will be able to destroy them. 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 20 to 27. 2 Kings 5, verse 20 to 27. Oh, thank you, Father. The Lord said, there's someone here tonight. He said, I have heard your cry. I will be merciful. Oh, thank you, Father. He said, there is someone here tonight that they called you a loser. I will make you a winner. In 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 20 to 27, you see how quickly a curse can bring death. A man called Gehazi lied against a man of God, and the man of God pronounced a curse on him and said, the leprosy of Naaman shall cleave unto thee and unto thy seed forever. Immediately, that man became a leper. And in those days, leprosy was incurable. That means his days were numbered. There's a story in Genesis 31 from verse 25 to 34. Genesis 31 from 25 to 34. Laban was pursuing Jacob. He said, you are running away. Where are you taking my elders with you? Jacob said, what do I need your idols for? If you find your idol with anybody in my company, let that fellow die. But Jacob didn't know that Rachel was sitting on the idol. So they searched the whole place. They couldn't find the idol. Rachel told the father, please, I'm sorry, I don't stand for you because my monthly period has come. That's why I'm not standing. So they didn't see her sitting on the idol. But the curse had gone forth from the husband's mouth. By the time you get to Genesis 35, verse 16 to 19, Genesis 35, verse 16 to 19, the following pregnancy that Rachel had was the one that she died with. That's why I'm appealing to all husbands. Whatever the offense of your wife, don't curse her. Because curse can kill. In Acts chapter 5, verse 1 to 11, Acts 5, verse 1 to 11, I think I can say amen to this one before I tell you. Almighty God says there's someone here tonight. He said, it doesn't matter how you feel now, I am still on your side. Acts chapter 5, verse 1 to 11. Ananias and Sapphira lied to the man of God. He pronounced a curse on them, and they all died the same day. Beware of curses. And of course, if the curse of a man can have so much power, how much more a curse from God? Mark 11, from verse 12 to 14, Mark 11, 12 to 14, and then 20 to 21, Jesus cursed a fig tree. He died overnight. So run away from the curse of God. That's why Malachi chapter 3, verse 8 to 11 is very important. Malachi 3, 8 to 11. Don't rob God. Don't rob him of his tithe. Don't rob him of his offering, so that his curse will not be upon you. It's a dangerous thing to be under the curse of God. Avoid curses. Thank you, Father. The Lord said there's someone here tonight. He said, your home has suddenly become a battleground. He asked me to tell you, he will show you that he's the Lord of hosts and restore peace to your home. Thank you, Father. The Lord wants me to tell you a story. Some of you have heard it before. Some of you who were here when it happened. An American preacher came to visit us several years ago when we were very small. And we were all very poor. And as he was preaching, like the Americans do, he just came down from the pulpit, stood in front of one young man, and said, thus saith the Lord, if you will serve me, I will make you a millionaire. And he said, amen. And he went straight back to the altar and continued preaching. I'm telling you, we were all envious. Why did he prophesy to just one man? What about me? And within six months, the young man had become a millionaire. I mean, miraculously. Before you knew what was happening, he has moved out of one room in Mushin where himself and wife and five children were living, to a flat, bought a new car for himself, a new car for his, money was just flowing. But then we didn't see him in church anymore. And we tried to follow up. No. Oh, it's business now. Today I'm in Geneva, tomorrow I'm in Switzerland, But God said, if you will serve me, I will make you a millionaire. Oh, I'm serving God. It's just that, my business partners find it easier to attend to me at weekends. And then one day I heard that he had a heart attack. Young man. So I sent people to go and pray for him. They prayed for him. I said, tell him when it's better he should come and see me. So he came. And when I asked questions, he told me he's just lost a contract worth hundreds of millions of naira. In those days when you can buy a Mercedes car for 12,000 naira. So you will know what hundreds of millions could mean. That's why he had the heart attack. I told him, God said, if you will serve me, I will make you a millionaire. Turn back to God, and all will still be well. When the Lord asked me to tell you that story, because there is someone here tonight, God asked me to tell you, your level is about to change. Please don't forget God. Do I hear amen now? Now, you want to live long. You want to enjoy abundant life. Avoid fruitlessness. When the Lord saves your soul, it is so that you too will save others. You bring others to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. God hates barrenness. Luke 13, verse 6 to 7. Luke 13, verse 6 to 7. The Lord tells us the story of a man who has a vineyard. He visited the vineyard and saw a tree there, big, full of leaves, but no fruit. He said to the gardener, cut it down. Why cumbereth it the ground? When God visits your church and he sees you there, big man, big woman, dancing, jumping up and down, and he says, how many souls have you brought to me? What will be your answer? John 15, verses 1 and 2. John 15, verses 1 and 2. He said, I am the vine, my Father is the husbandman. I am the vine, you are the branches. Any branch in me that beareth fruit, he purgeth it so he can bring forth more fruit. Any branch in me that beareth no fruit, he tears it away. If you are not a soul winner, it means you love death rather than life. I was talking to a 90-year-old man not too long ago. 90. See healthy, strong. You shake his hand. You think you are shaking the hand of a 20-something-year-old man. I said, sir, what is the secret of your health and strength? He said, I am a soul winner. Every Sunday, I bring somebody new to church. Every Sunday. Every Sunday, somebody new. Every Sunday. And only last week, I heard of somebody who in 1 week brought 59 people to church. 59. 1 week. One man. And there are some of us, since the year began, we've not brought a single soul to Jesus Christ. Be careful. Because God is not going to tolerate fruitlessness for long. And then, the next thing my son had already mentioned, honor your parents. Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. Exodus 20, verse 12. Honor your father and your mother that your days might be long. Why must you honor your parents? Because of the law of harvest. If you honor your parents, you will live long to become a parent. You honor your parents, you won't die young, so that you too can become a parent, so that your children can honor you. Law of harvest. No matter how bad you think your parents are, they are the ones who took care of you before you became anybody. Have you forgotten those days when you were absolutely helpless? Have you forgotten those days when all you could do to tell them that you have a problem is cry because you couldn't talk yet? Have you forgotten those days when they couldn't sleep because you were not sleeping? Honor your parents that you may live long. The blessing of your parents will take you far. I've told you before, I say I'm where I am today by the grace of God and the blessing of my mother. I told you, any time I did something that pleased her when I was young, she had only one prayer for me. And she would say it in Yoruba, because she couldn't speak English, so she couldn't pronounce Enoch very well. Eloku. You will call one fellow, 200 will answer. I didn't understand what that meant. But today, I can see the fulfillment of our prayers. Honor your parents. Biological. Then honor your parents, spiritual. God was speaking in Malachi chapter 1 verse 6. Malachi 1 verse 6. He said, if I be your father, where is my honor? God expects us to honor our spiritual parents. I've told you before, when your spiritual parent says you are blessed, it means you are blessed. I've said it before. Many a times I say it on credit, knowing that one day you will wake up and I say, God bless you. But blessings don't come free. No. Isaac said to Esau, go and get me the kind of food I like, that I may be able to bless you from the bottom of my heart. While Esau was gone, Jacob came in, gave Papa good food. Papa poured the blessing on Jacob. Jacob walked out, Esau came in and said, Papa said, my stomach is already full. I've already poured out the blessings. Don't you have anyone left? Well, I've already made him your Lord. I can't change that. Blessings from your parents can prolong your life. But blessings don't come for nothing. Honor your parents. I told you the story of two boys, two young men who saw me in Heathrow years ago, carrying two heavy carry-on luggages because there wasn't enough money to pay extra excess luggage. I packed all the heavy things, the books, into the hand luggages. because they won't weigh those ones. I was sweating, carrying them. And then I met two of my sons. Ah, good morning, Daddy. Good morning, Daddy. I said, good morning to the first one. The second one rushed to me. Hey, let me help you carry your luggages. I said, ah, God bless you. The first one turned to me. I said, Daddy, you didn't say God bless me. I said, for what? You said, good morning. I said, good morning. This one honored me, so God bless you. Well, I will do it on credit again tonight. All of you, my children, God bless you. Honor God. He's the Father of all fathers. That's what he said in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 to 10. Proverbs 3, verse 9 to 10. He said, honor me with your first fruit. Honor. God doesn't need your money. He needs honor. And then finally, be holy. I'm sure you know that's where I went. Oh, thank you, Father. Two weeks ago, we were in Canada for our convention. And we had a testimony, one of the greatest testimonies I've had in my life. God is asking me to share the testimony with you because he wants to do something for someone. A lady stepped forward and said, she was born without ovaries. And her fallopian tubes were not properly formed, which means there was absolutely no way she could have a child. So she said, then we came for one program in Canada, my wife and I. And when we finished, everybody was struggling to sit on my chair. And she decided, I'm not going to sit on Daddy's chair. I'm going to the wife's chair. He said she got to my wife's chair and said to God, Daddy just told us that you have spare parts in heaven. Even if you don't have my own spare parts, give me the ovary of the woman who sat here, give me her fallopian tube, she doesn't need them anymore. And God answered her because she stood before us with two beautiful children. And so the Lord asked me to tell someone here tonight. Tonight, you are getting brand new fallopian tubes. Ah, thank you, Father. I can hear a song. And it's coming from the home of someone. And I want to sing the song to you. It's an old song. Singing praise to the Lord. Singing hallelujah. Singing praise to the Lord. Singing hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Singing hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. singing hallelujah, singing praise to the Lord. Singing hallelujah, singing praise to the Lord. Singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Singing hallelujah. Thus saith the Lord, before the end of this month, that song is coming from the home of song. Oh, thank you, my Father. Please be seated. Finally, be holy. Romans chapter 6, verse 23. Romans 6, verse 23 says, the wages of sin is death. So you don't want to die? Stay away from sin. If anyone tells you that once you are born again, you can continue in sin, that fellow wants to kill you. The wages of sin is death. And the word of God is forever settled. And you know what? All sins are bad. But one of the most dangerous of all sins is the sin of adultery. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6 to 7. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 6 to 7. Almighty God says, when you are born again, you become the temple of God. The Spirit of God now dwells in you. And he says, if you defile the temple of God, God will destroy you. Stay away from adultery. Stay away from fornication. Keep the temple of the Almighty God pure, so that you may live long. In closing, like my son told you, in Jesus is life. If you abide in him, his life will abide in you. You'll be fruitful. You'll be joyful. You'll be successful. So those of you who are not yet in Christ, those of you who have not yet surrendered your life to Jesus, I appeal to you, come to him tonight. In him is life.